The next person is someone very close to us. The topic is gynaecological conditions. It's good when someone talks to you out of experience. I think it makes more impact. It carries a lot of weight, as opposed to, I read this from a book. This lady is going to speak to us out of experience. It's called her life story. She is the founder of Special Lady Awareness, and she established the foundation after experiencing a challenging health journey. As a matter of fact, she uses her story to encourage other women and young girls to seek adequate medical care. This is the kind of message we have to drive home where we come from. Because unfortunately, a lot of things are still going on. In fact, not only back home, even here. Maybe as a result of fear or, I don't know, so many factors lead to that. But you hear from our sister, over 3 years, she's visited her country of origin, which is Ghana, and donated over 30,000 items, such as sanitary towels, books, medical essentials, clothing, and toys. Her story has appeared in the United Kingdom Mirror, in the USA, and many countries in the world. Ladies and gentlemen, she is no other person than our own sister. You are not just, by now you should be a doctor. Honorable Mrs. Elizabeth Amoaa, put your hands together for her. Thank you so much.
And she's a woman of the world.
Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. First of all, I would like to say thank you for your presence. My name is Elizabeth Amoaa, and I'm the founder of a charity organization called The Special Lady. So I was born in Ghana, as you said, that's my country of origin. And I remember from the age of 6 years old, I was in and out of hospitals with recurrent thrush and viral infections and vaginal infections. And whenever I used to complain to my family, they thought it was just a normal abdominal pain. The pains continued till I was about 12 years old when I moved to France to join my family. And I remember it didn't stop. I was always in and out of hospitals. And during my puberty, it was very challenging. I used to have a lot of heavily menstrual periods, and it was very irregular. And obviously, as usual, I kept insisting that I need to get checked. Yes, I did have so many checks up, but no one really knew what was wrong with me. They kept telling me, oh, it's just a menstrual period, you know, it's normal, and you will go as you grow, or when you give birth, as I know back home, as we always used to say. And I carried on as normal, as I said. But then I moved to the UK in 2003 to further my education, and it didn't stop. Kept going to the hospitals with more infections. And as I said, at one point, I remember the doctors thinking that it was in my head or I was making it up. So each time within me, I knew that, no, this, I'm not actually making it up. Something is actually wrong somewhere. So it carried on and I kept insisting and pleading. No one listened to my concerns. So 2008, when I fainted, I remember, my husband now, then was my boyfriend. So when they took me to the hospital, I had a scan and they diagnosed me with uterine fibroids and also infertility. So they told me, obviously, I can never have a child. So I thought, okay. Anyway, I'm at university and that is the least thing that, you know, I'm worried about. So I will just carry on as normal and focus on my education. So I completed my education and when I went to do my master's, 4 months onto the course, I felt pregnant. I thought, okay, I thought I cannot have a child. What's going on? So when I end up in the hospital again, they told me that, oh, don't get too excited because of your condition, because the fibroids were located in the womb and you can easily lose the child. At one point, I remember when I have a scan, they would tell me, oh, there is no baby in your womb. You have to give a baby because it's a topic pregnancy. And I'll go back and I'll be like, really? That cannot be a topic pregnancy because I know I'm pregnant. I could feel that I'm pregnant. But then having said that, I was studying master's in law. So I thought, okay, you know what? Let me focus on my education because it's quite a challenging course. So maybe I'm too stressed. So I personally was also basing it on the education. And so one point, I remember when full effort and try to advise me to abort my child. They told me that, oh, even if you give birth to her, she won't survive. Because, you know, it's strange that one minute we can find a baby in your womb, the next there's no baby. We do not know what is going on. And I remember telling my family and my boyfriend, obviously, that time we were not married, and he kept saying, no, there is a baby. Let's keep or hold up the faith and hope, and the baby will come. I carried my daughter through to the master's program. I remember giving birth to her just 1 week. I submitted my dissertation. She came 7 months pregnant. Yes, during the whole pregnancy, I bled. When I say I bled, it wasn't even a normal period pains. I could bleed so heavy that I'll be thinking, oh, I've lost the baby. And then 1 minute, we go to the hospital, the baby's there. Then the following week, oh, there was no baby. And then they kept saying, oh, because you've got fibroids, and the fibroids is located in the womb, so the fibroids is growing with the baby. So maybe that's why. So fast forward, I gave birth to my daughter, and I thought everything was fine. After 6 months, the pain started again. At this time, I started fainting all the time. I could start screaming that I'm in pain, and then I would end up on the floor, ambulance, hospital. They would scan me again. They would still tell me it's fibroids. And I kept insisting, this is more than fibroids, because I know that fibroids do not cause fainting. And all the symptoms, like having a migraine, feeling always like I want to throw up. So that, I knew within me that this is not just fibroids, but obviously, as usual, the medical professionals kept ruling it on fibroids. So it went on and went on, and in 2014, that time I was married to my husband, because he's in the British Army, so we moved to Germany. And when we got to Germany, I said, yes, this is the time for me to get a private healthcare. As a lot of people know that in Germany, they do have a very good healthcare facilities. So I played with the British Army medical professionals, and they gave me a private medical care. And this is where I had to undergo a series of tests, from swabs to scans to blood tests, name it, all the tests on this earth I had. And finally, I was put into a machine. And when I came out, obviously, a week after the results came, and they told me I was born with a different type of womb. Most women have one womb. However, I do have two wombs. And I do know a lot of stories are coming out recently with women with two wombs. So to me, it was a shock when they told me I had two wombs. I thought, oh, this is not normal. I'm an alien. But having said that, I was still happy because I thought, okay, so all this, you know, ordeal or all these challenges that I was facing, it wasn't in my head. It was actually because I am born different. And I thought, okay, I have the two womb. It's fine. Let's get on. They said, no, it's not fine. Having two womb means you are prone to other gynecological conditions. So I thought, okay. So what's next? They said, okay, now we have to do operation on you. We have to operate you. We need to look inside the womb and check that you do not have any other. So I undergo a surgery, and I remember the first one wasn't successful, although they put me to sleep, they prepared me for the surgery, and apparently my womb was shut, both womb was shut, so they couldn't go through the womb, so I have to wake up again, and then they book for a second surgery, and that time they have to go underpass, obviously, so they forced open the womb. And they discovered that I wasn't only born with two wombs, I was also born with two cervices and two vagina canals, which is called uterus decalvus. And because of that condition, I was prone to obviously other infections. So they also find out that I had endometriosis. However, it was a severe stage because it had spread to my bladder at that time. And I remember when I was told this, I thought, what? I felt so sad, and I told God, I remember that, God, you hate me that much. After everything that I've been through since I was a child, this is too much for me to take. Because being told I can't have a child, I have a child, I'm thinking everything is fine, and now, why this? But then I remember telling myself that, you know what, maybe there was a purpose or there is a reason why I have to go through this. So why don't you think of coming out and tell your story? I thought, okay, I will do that, as usual, postpone my dreams. And I carry on, and I was able to get fertility treatment. So I fell pregnant again with my second child. And as usual, they told me, do not keep your hopes too high, you will lose this baby. So we moved back to UK in 2016. I was 2 months pregnant. And I carried on as usual, great job. And 2 months later, which would be 4 months, I find out that I was having like pains in my tummy. Bleeding. So I thought, okay, I'm not having miscarriage, what's going on? And when I ended up in the hospital, they had a scan and they told me, you're only 2 months pregnant, obviously. I thought, no, it can't be, I'm 4 months pregnant. And I have to then force them to get my medical file from Germany. And it was established that, yes, I was 4 months pregnant. However, I experienced something called silent miscarriage, which is like a mixed abortion or mixed miscarriage. It's like a miscarriage that a woman do not shed the blood. So the blood was stuck inside my womb for a good 2 months. I thought, okay. I remember them telling me, we do not know how long, you know, you can even live because it can kill you. And because of the type of womb you have, it's not easy for us to get rid of the dead fetus. So you have to have another surgery. So another consultant said, oh, no, well, let's try abortion pill. That might get the blood out. They gave me that, it didn't work. Some of the blood came. I had another scan. The dead fetus was still there. And I remember closing my eyes and telling God, God, if you let me out of this situation, I promise you that the whole world will hear about me. They will know my story. And I will use my story to encourage other women and young girls out there who may have my condition or who may have the symptoms and signs that I have had through all these years. So God, please spare me. Oh yeah, it was like, you know, signing a contract with God. So when the surgery was performed, it was successful. And I said, I remember a week when I came out, I just went online, started the blog. And that's where the job started. And as you can see, I've traveled to Ghana on numerous occasions. I have been to schools, been to communities, carried out a lot of outreach. And whenever I go, I don't talk only about women reproductive health, I also talk about menstrual hygiene. The reason being, all the symptoms or signs mostly start during our puberty. So I always make sure I encourage them and teach them what to do, how to eat healthy, and how to live a healthy lifestyle, and also let people know how they're feeling. You know, there is no point of you keeping things to yourself or thinking people will not understand, because I'm the type, I'm very stubborn. Even if you don't listen to me, I will keep telling you how I feel. So it's, well, as I said, what I do is telling them the story, giving them the symptoms, and also educating them on gynaecological conditions and menstrual hygiene. I know people will think, oh yeah, it's easy. It sounds like it's easy. Everything was carried out well. So you've been to Ghana, 1,000 items. Trust me, it's not easy. It is a lot stressful. I was a lot of challenges, a lot of society backlash, stereotyping. Yes, I've had names. People telling me I was lying, I was making it up. Even when I had 3 documentaries that was screened in Ghana on so many different media platforms, my stories were in the newspapers, and yes, so people were doubting me. Until I think just a couple of weeks ago, another lady from Australia came out, she had the same condition as me, and she was able to have twins, or I think 4 children. And then one of my friends was like, you see, now the devil is a liar. You know, the only one in the double room. It is actually true. I said, of course it's true. Why would I make this up? The reason why I'm sharing my story with people or telling my story is I want people to know that we do not make up. When women say they are in pain or when we complain about menstrual pains, menstrual pains is not just, you know, what we feel, just a normal one. You take painkillers and you go. Mine wasn't like that. I have taken some of the most strong painkillers that you can ever think of. I have had antidepressants, I've had antibiotics, name it, all the medication on this earth they've given me, and it wasn't working for my pains. So, special lady have decided that I'm going to share my story. As she said, the Mirror UK, they did feature my story, and my story or documentary is coming out soon with Born Different, which a lot of people follow them on social media, and they also come on the TV. And it will go through my story from when I was a child to now, and where I intend to go with this advocacy work. So I will not stand here and, you know, just talk about it, because this, I'll go in and go on, but as we could see from all the pictures, there are a lot of young students, I would say, that also are experiencing some of mine. Probably a lot of us in here are also experiencing some of mine. Some have been diagnosed infertile, which is some may also don't know what's wrong with them. Some might have some conditions that they're not comfortable to talk about, especially coming from an African background. I do understand these topics are so unspoken, but I'm pleading with all of us that it doesn't matter. You're not alone. You're special. You're unique. And you're born to make an impact. So when Auntie Jessica contacted me with Women at the Wall, I thought, yes, this is a perfect platform for me to relate to other women and tell my story. And I'm so grateful to be part of this organization because I'm giving the platform to stand here today and share my life and share my story so that someone else will use my story as a motivational tool to seek adequate medical medical care and support. So all I want to say is thank you for being here today and thank you. And it's been a privilege to share my story with you. My social media angles, I'm on Facebook as Special Lady, and I'm on YouTube as Special Lady Awareness. And my website is www.speciallady.awareness.com. You can visit me, message me, let me know if you know somebody or yourself, you're going through any gynaecological conditions. I'm always here to help. I'm open 24 hours, 7. I do not sleep, so, you know, just get in touch. Thank you.
I don't think that's enough round of applause. Yeah. Can we make it better?